So now let's go ahead and get to our featured presenter today. He's a veteran of Oasis. He's been a member of our community since the very beginning. One of our largest boosters. He's an absolutely outstanding member. If you're not, he hardly needs an introduction, but in case someone in the audience isn't familiar with everything that Dr. Darrel Ray has done, he's the author of several books, which are featured up on the board right there. He is also the host of the Secular Sexuality podcast, which I highly recommend listening to. He's the founder and president of Recovering from Religion and the director of the Secular Therapy Project. So, without further ado, to talk about his life and activism, Dr. Darrel Ray.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I'm always happy to talk at Oasis, but how do I follow MK? I mean, dang. I don't have a beagle. That was great. I loved listening to that. I was getting out of the car here, and I think it was Brian or somebody was bringing in this big thing of something. And I said, what is that? And Barb says, well, that's the toilet paper for the toilet paper drive. And I said, oh, shit. I said, that was the wrong answer. So I have a whole bunch of toilet paper I forgot to bring. So anyway, that's neither here nor there. Well, today we're going to talk about what I learned in a lifetime of activism. And we're going to start at the very beginning. I want to define what activism is to me, what the term activism means. And that is less, but I want to start with a quote from Saul Alinsky. Now, he is one of my heroes of activism. How many of you have read Rules for Radicals? Oh, there are a few people. Great, great. Paige, you read it? Cool, you just went up three degrees in my estimation. Good job. And MK, you've read it too. Okay, good. So here's what he says. Lest we forget, from all our legends, mythology, and history, the first radical known to man to have rebelled against the establishment and did so effectively that he at least won his own kingdom, Lucifer, by Saul Alinsky. Saul Alinsky was a very good atheist, by the way. How many of you in here would consider yourselves an activist in some form or other? Okay, maybe a third of the people. I hope to get more hands by the end of this session. Because I think there's more of you that really are activists. You just may not know it from the direction I'm going to come from. Here's my definition of activism. The process of actively and openly pursuing a social goal. Activism is not inherently good or positive or progressive. The religious right are activists, but they certainly are not progressive. Some of the left are activists, and they're happy to campaign against free speech. They don't agree with the free speech. So you can see on both sides, activists doing things that aren't particularly progressive necessarily. So that's my definition of activism. Of course, I'm very into progressive activism. I want to actually help people. I don't want to take people's health care away, and I don't want to throw people out of jobs. I want actually to do something positive with in my world. So here is my journey through activism. We're going to begin at the very beginning. This is my family. And we were all very religious. My parents actually became missionaries once they retired. Missionaries to Mexico. Missions in Mexico Incorporated was their mission. And this is me here. Big ears and all. And we went to Westside Christian Church in Wichita, Kansas. Now I'm going to go talk in Wichita in late February. I'm not going to give this talk. Well, you know, I might. I don't know. I ought to tell them all about my time in Wichita, shouldn't I? Since that's my hometown. I was very, very serious about my religious upbringing. But I was also very liberal. I had no doubt about evolution. Not from the very beginning. I once found some fossils, some fossil shark's teeth, and I showed them to my aunt. I said, Aunt, how did fossil sharks get clear up there on top of that mesa? And it was in New Mexico. And she said, well, no, it put them there in the flood. And I thought to myself, I won't use the word, but you don't know what you're talking about. So at Westside Christian, I was raised very religious. I did all sorts. I was in every, you know, we were in church 3 to 5 times a week. So, and there wasn't any question about it. If you didn't want to go to church, you better be on your deathbed or in the hospital, or out of town or something, but you're going to be in church if you're anywhere even somewhat healthy. But I took it seriously. I was very committed to helping people. And as I look back in my life, I think, helping people is what I wanted to do, not believe in some bullshit mythology. But at the time, I still believed much of the mythology. I didn't believe anybody rose from the dead. I never believed that stuff. It just didn't stick with me. But being good to people and kind and helpful, and some of the, you know, I thought there probably were some spirits in the world and things that helped you and that sort of stuff, angels, and who knows? I didn't know for sure. I was skeptical, but I still believe some of it. I mean, at the ripe old age of 16, what are you going to do? You believe what you're told. And I was so incredibly religious that in 1967, I completed, after almost 2 years of work, I completed my God and Country Award. Now, at that time, I was the only scout that had ever achieved the God and Country Award. Some people thought of it as higher than Eagle Scout. It's not, but some people thought, wow, that's even better than Eagle Scout. It takes years to get it, and nobody had ever gotten it anywhere near in our, what do they call, the district Boy Scouts? At the time I did it, nobody could remember anybody getting the God and Country Award in our district. Not just my troop, but the whole district. And so that tells you how hard I worked. This hundreds of hours of work and study and interviews with religious people and just all sorts of stuff you have to do for it. I'm told it's easier to get now than it used to be, but I don't know. I don't pay attention to the Boy Scouts except when they're trying to keep the gays out. So my parents left our church, Westside Christian Church, and went to Antioch Christian Church to found it. They were the founding members. They actually started two different churches in their lifetimes, this being one of the two churches they helped start. The previous church was a church called Riverside Christian Church, and they left after the minister had his second affair. But that's all right. They went and founded this church, and of course, this minister, 10 years later, got fired for having an affair. You see a pattern here? I was not going to talk about sex here today. I wasn't going to do that. I just can't avoid it, can I? Well, it was a non-sexual affair, I'm guessing. Maybe so. Anyway, so my parents go there, and they spent 2 or 3 years in the mid-60s founding this church of Antioch Christian Church, and then they leave. Now, when I was attending it, it was a school. We were meeting in a school auditorium, not a beautiful facility like this. I went back about 1970 and applied to be their youth minister. So this is me as a youth minister in about 1970. Now, you guys laughed at that. I'm not sure why you would laugh. I think I look like Ringo Starr. Don't you think so? Ringo Starr? Right. Barb didn't think so. I don't agree with her. I think I look like Ringo Starr. Not nose isn't quite big enough, but other than that, don't you love that haircut? So here I am, the youth minister. And you got to remember, everybody in this church knows that my parents founded this church. So that gives me plenty of leeway to you know, I can get away with shit. So I start doing things like teaching evolution in Sunday school. What else is there to do? I'm a college anthropology major, and I'm learning all about evolution. I want to teach these kids. Oh, you can believe in God and evolution at the same time. It's no big deal. Here you go. Well, they let me teach evolution in Sunday school, but they always had one of the elders' wives always attended my Sunday school class. No other elders' wives attended anybody's Sunday school class except mine, and I always had a spy, so to speak. Now, she was a wonderful lady, and she and I got along. She approved of me teaching it. I don't know why, but she did. Anyway, that was the kind of stuff I was doing. Pretty radical stuff for a 20-year-old. Youth minister, wouldn't you say? I mean, you wouldn't get away with that today. They would kick you out in a heartbeat in most churches if you start teaching evolution. I was attending Friends University in Wichita, Kansas at the time, working on my bachelor's degree, and I met this great guy. He and I just clicked. And he was a minister. He's black. He was a minister of a black Christian church in town. Well, that's the same denomination we are. Fuck, I didn't know they had black churches in our denomination. That was news to me. Nobody ever said there was an independent Christian church with black people in it. I'd never seen anything like that before. So he and I just had a great time together. We really enjoyed each other. So we had a brilliant idea. Let's bring our youth groups together and have a youth group meeting Sunday evening. So he brought his kids in his bus, and all the kids got out, and my kids were already there. And you know, I had the hardest time. I was in that job for about a year and a half. I had the hardest time getting any parents to come help me corral these 25 or 30 hormonal teenagers on Sunday evenings, except that evening. And I had a dozen parents show up. And when the bus drove up with the other kids in it, they herded the white kids into the building and said, all you kids, get over here and let our guests get over here. So all the black kids come into our building and they force all the kids to get into this side of the building. And I am just blown away. I have no idea. I can't believe what I'm seeing here. That's not the purpose. The purpose is us forget to mingle and get to know each other. Ain't no way that's going to happen today. I could figure that out. I gave my lesson, and at the end of it, they said, let's let our guests have the refreshments first. And they let them all get out and go out out of the building. And they didn't let the white kids go outside at all, just the black kids. And that was a big hint, get on the bus and get out of here. I can't tell you how it felt that time. I can't tell you how embarrassed, how angry, how incredibly furious I was with this church that I was trying simply to be like Jesus, you know. Jesus loves the little, my grandmother had sang, Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Yeah, we can do it. And I believed it. I didn't realize that was just propaganda. So that went so well. After getting fired from Antioch Christian Church for, I don't know why, you know, they had promised me a raise. I was getting $5 a week to do the youth group in Sunday school. In 1970, even that was pretty bad, $5 a week. But they promised me they would double it if I did a good job. I did a good job. We went from 5 kids a week to 25 kids a week, and I got fired. So anyway, after I got fired, I went back to my home church where I decided, well, if it doesn't work there, maybe it'll work here. So I became a Sunday school teacher. Not this kind of Sunday school, this kind of Sunday school. I had seniors in high school, so I can really jive with them. I'm a college junior by this time, and these kids look up to me, and I'm teaching them all sorts of stuff. And I propose that I can teach evolution to them, too. But the elder in charge of the Sunday school shut that down real quick. Nope, you got to stick with the Bible, period. So I stuck with the Bible. I also became a camp counselor. Man, I was doing all sorts of stuff. I don't know how I had time to go to college, too. And work 3 part-time jobs to pay for my school at the time. But I was a church camp counselor with lots of hormonal kids. And I was probably just as hormonal as any of the kids at the camp. So I'm supposed to be advising them, you know, on all sorts of stuff like don't masturbate. Even though I just did it that morning myself. All right. So. But I was very committed to Jesus. I was committed to the church. And I decided, we need to expand this ministry. We need to get more people in our church. Because it was kind of a metropolitan church that was starting to die. A lot of people getting older and older and not as many kids coming in. So I said, well, let's go out and get some kids. So I started a bus ministry. A bus ministry. You guys know what a bus ministry is? Well, it's going around in doors and knocking on and saying, you want to send your kid to church? Well, what I did was I went to all the housing projects around and I knocked on doors and said, you want to send your kids to church? And these parents looked at me like, let's see, Sunday morning, no kids in the house, free babysitting. Sure, sign me up. I had like 45 kids coming onto my bus. We had a full bus, like the very first Sunday. No problem. And we'd get on that bus and come to church. No, this is not what our bus looked like. This is the kind of things kids our bus looked like. And this is what the little old ladies looked like when I brought all these 35 to 40 kids. A black person had never been inside of our church. I dare say I had never seen one. Not even the janitor was a black person. I mean, it was really amazing how I could be totally isolated in a city that probably was 20% minorities, and I had never seen a minority in my whole life until I went out and found people. And the interesting thing was some of them were living 2 blocks from where I lived as a child, where I grew up. That's how isolated you can be in a city. Well, we know this. It's not news to any of us right now. But it was a shock to me, a 20-year-old kid, realizing that I had been isolated. There were churches that had the same denominational name as us, and they were of different race, different color, and nobody talked about it. That's really kind of weird. So anyway, moving right along. That bus ministry did really well. And I had a guy who was my trainee. He was there to help me. He was on the bus every day and helped me to control the kids. And he was supposed to take it over when I moved out of town to go to Nashville, Tennessee, which I'll come back and talk about in a minute, to go to graduate school. Amazing. That bus ministry stopped the week I left. They never moved that bus off the parking lot after that to pick up anybody except other Christian white kids. So that was a major blow. My own home church had basically betrayed me. Now, I'm not going to say I was enlightened. I was probably had a lot of racism in me. I don't know. I'm not saying I'm perfect. But I was learning really fast how racist our church was. And it was having a major impact on who I was and who I wanted to be and what I wanted to be with my life. At the same time, of course, Vietnam War is going on, and I am draft eligible, and I am not happy about that. And I'm also reading Jesus' stuff. You know, I think the way you read the Bible is you can find anything you want in the Bible, especially the New Testament, about Jesus, and I found out he was a pacifist, because Friends University is a Quaker school, and a lot of my friends were Quakers, so I was learning all about Quaker theology and Quaker funerals. And Quaker weddings. And there's nothing like a Quaker wedding or a Quaker funeral. If you get an opportunity, go crash a Quaker funeral. They are really, really interesting. So I kind of started considering myself a Quaker at that time, even though I wasn't. I still was in my church and all, but I kind of absorbed that Quaker idea. And there was a fellow named Roy Ray, no relation to me. He was the president of French University at the time. And I proposed to Roy, well, you know, we ought to have an anti-war protest right here on campus because we're a Quaker school and we're against war. Quakers are pacifists. But he was a Presbyterian. I don't know how he got to be president of the university, but he said no. So I said, okay. I went to my friend Phil Kenyon, who is a part-time janitor in the building that you see here, and he had the keys to the tower, this tower right here, right there. And we went up there with, and we opened the tower lock. You couldn't get into the tower. You know, you had to have special permission. He got us into the tower, and we flew a kite from the tower at midnight. We got up there at midnight, flew the kite from the tower, and came back down and locked the door with another padlock that they did not have a key to. And then we went just watched to see what would happen. It took them till noon to get it down. And here's what the kite said, had on it. If you can't see it from there, it says, "Stop the war, Mickey Mouse, Dr. Roy Ray." I'd have gotten kicked out of school if they'd have figured out who. To this day, nobody knows. I've never confessed. Well, I have now, of course. Well, I confessed on our 20th anniversary, I confessed that I was the one that had done it. Nobody knew. Everybody, who did the kite thing? And it turned out, no, I was pretty good. I could be a spy. Speaking of spies, we have a Russian spy in our midst here right now. Where is she? Where's Tay? Tay, where are you? Right there. All right, Tay's right here, fresh back from Russia. Cool. You gotta get to know Tay. She is phenomenal, fantastic. And I'm going to put a word in. I think she ought to talk about her trip to Russia sometime at Oasis. So anyway. All right. Well, moving right along. As you can tell, I'm not real fond of my university. Here's the way you can look at university. But I could tell lots of stories. In fact, most of the stories I'm going to tell you here today, I've got long versions of. You're getting the really, really short versions of all these stories. Some of them are a lot better in the long version. Most aren't. But anyway. So let's fast forward to Skerritt College for Christian Workers. Now, Skerritt College was actually founded right here in Kansas City, but in like 1932 or something, it moved to Nashville, Tennessee. And they have this gorgeous campus. I looked all over the United States for campuses or colleges, graduate schools. This is a graduate school that would meet my needs. I wanted to become an activist within the church, not outside. And this they had an entire program called Church and Community, which was really teaching people how to be activists inside of the church. That's pretty cool. So I went there for a two-year master's degree. And during that time, I worked in a halfway house for young women. We were the weekend house parents. It was a job, but it was also part of something I was really committed to, is helping people in that situation. And I helped black senior citizens fill out the paperwork to overcome all the bureaucratic hoops that were put in their way intentionally by the Jim Crow kind of laws and regulations they had in Tennessee at the time. When I moved to Tennessee, they still had blacks only, or coloreds only, or whites only signs above the water fountains. They still had them. Now, they were illegal and nobody followed them, of course, but they were still there. That's another, wow, that's just like mind-boggling that those signs are still up there years after the many Supreme Court rulings. So I finished my work there, and by the time I was finished with Skerritt College, I was so damn liberal I could probably be called an agnostic, maybe not yet an atheist, but pretty close to it. I was very, very religious, very, very non-religious, and I moved from there into a Quaker church. I started attending the local Quaker silent meeting. Quakers don't have ministers? They don't even talk. They just sit there and are quiet for an hour. And every now and then somebody might stand up and say something profound. So we went there for about a year and a half or 2 years. But that was the extreme of my liberality. I still had to be in church because my wife at the time insisted we had to go to church somewhere. So we went to the Quaker church, which she absolutely hated. She didn't like sitting there being silent. She wanted to tell her what to do. So then I started my doctoral work at Vanderbilt. I was at Vanderbilt going through my doctorate in counseling psychology. And I was also working in an institution full-time called Spencer Youth Center for delinquent boys. And they had like 400 delinquent boys in an institution that was built for 220. And it was really bad, really overcrowded. And I was the senior therapist in the maximum security unit, which is just what it sounds like. It was pretty nasty, pretty difficult. And the kids in there were in there for everything from murder to armed robbery, rape. I mean, it's pretty bad stuff. But they were in the 14 to 16 age range. That's who I generally worked with. But it was overcrowded. There were way too many kids in here. And that inspired me to do my doctoral research with double-blind controls on my stuff, because I wanted to be legitimate. And I got a United States government grant to do my research inside the institution. I hired some research assistants, and they did a lot of the testing and stuff, so you know I couldn't bias the sample. And they themselves did not know where everything was coming from. Anyway, as a result of this report, we got a lot of evidence that you cram too many people into an institution like that, you're going to get a lot of problems. And this particular report got sent to the state legislature, it got sent to the governor, and we published it in three different journals over the course of the next 3 or 4 years. As a result, it became part of a lawsuit. And the lawsuit, I got called in to be an expert witness. The interesting thing was, two of the kids in this lawsuit, as local legal aid was supporting these kids, and they had decided to sue the government to force them to stop putting kids with mental disabilities into this institution and to stop them overcrowding it. So I got called to be a witness from the state side, because I was an employee at the time. And the funny thing, they wanted me to testify against the state, even as I was a witness for the state, because the state wanted to force the legislature to give them money. And then I left, and I got called back as a witness on the other side of the thing, because now I had a dissertation that proved this was a problem. The legal aid people said I'm the only person they have ever heard of that testified on both sides of a lawsuit. One's an expert, and one is a witness, because I was their therapist. Anyway, this is Spencer Youth Center after it was redesigned. About 5 years after this report came out, I went to visit. I wanted to see what it was like. And I go and I knock on the front door, and there's nobody there except the superintendent. So he comes out, and you know what Cool Hand Luke, the guard, this guy looked and acted just like him. What we have here is a failure to communicate. You know that one? That's what he looked at. He like, or a sheriff, you know, a southern sheriff. I'd never known this guy. I mean, the superintendent was there when I was there. It was long gone. So he said, what do you want? I said, well, I just want to go around and kind of look and see the place I used to work and check in with some of my old friends. He said, well, come on, I'll show you around. So we go walking around. He's taking me into each building and showing me what all happened. About halfway through, he said, you know, some asshole wrote a report and made us put $12 million into this place. I didn't tell him I was the asshole. I didn't tell him that. And I got, the minute I was out, finished with that tour, I shook his hand, said thank you, and I got out of there. I don't know that he ever knew who he was actually talking to. But that was Spencer Youth Center, $12 million. And I'm very proud of that. As a part of my activism, they also were forced to cut the number of kids they put into the institution and follow a whole bunch of rules. We put 13 recommendations in, and when I went back, I found that 11 of our recommendations had been implemented by the court. The legislature and governor wouldn't do it, but the court did. So then I went on into a career of organizational psychology and teaching people how to actually treat each other in the workplace. Now, that may not sound like activism, but I was doing a lot of teaching people how to be respectful, how to work within diverse work environments, how to be culturally sensitive to other people. I mean, all sorts of stuff was coming out as a result of just my work. And from these are two of my books that I wrote there during my career. Now, I was active in other places, but I don't have time to tell you all these stories. I got to get into the meat of things. So I then published The God Virus, and that was in 2009 it came out. And Bill's got my shirt on here. He's the smartest guy in the whole group, by the way, because he's got my shirt on. Yeah, best looking too. Yeah, right, next to me. So I wrote The God Virus, and my staff at the time in my business said, oh, Darrel, we're going to lose all our clients. I said, well, we may lose a few. And I went ahead and published the book, and 6 months later, I didn't have any clients. So thank goodness the book sold enough. It was a bestseller. Thank goodness it sold enough for me to make up much, not all, but much of the income I lost. But I basically lost my business within 2 years after publishing this book. Amazing. Clients I'd had for 20 years stopped returning my phone calls, stopped responding to my emails. I was no different person. They loved me. You don't hire a consultant for 20 years straight unless you think they're doing a damn good job. So I must have been doing a damn good job for a half a dozen different companies that I'd been with for up to 20 years. And many more, of course, that had been working for like 4 and 5 years. And just suddenly, I had never expected that kind of discrimination, if you will. But I'm a consultant. They don't have to hire me. There's no laws that protect consultants from that kind of discrimination. So let's move on and find out what I learned. Well, first of all, I learned that no person or organization is perfect. So get over it. Organizations are not perfect, and if you expect them to be, you'll never be happy. You'll never be satisfied. Don't let the perfect get in the way of the possible. And I hear a lot of people saying, well, I don't want to belong to Oasis because they're not perfect. I don't want to give the ACLU because they've defended somebody I don't like. I don't want to, you know, give blood because the blood donating people are dumb or something. I don't. There's all sorts of, not you, Amber, the blood donor. So I just see it as an excuse for not getting involved. If you wait for perfection, you'll never get anything done. And I see far too many potentially really good activists letting the perfect get in the way of the possible. Learning number two is those who complain the loudest are often contribute the least. And they will also drag everyone else down if you pay attention to them. So stop paying attention to the moaners, whiners, and complainers. I'm going to come back and give you some other things on that in a minute. But those who complain the loudest, those who whine, I want to find out what have you done lately? And a lot of times they haven't done diddly squat. Here's where I'm going to get into some controversial, just briefly, if you want to be mad at me at the end, fine. But I see, one place I see this happening a lot in our movement is secular bloggers. Most secular bloggers are whiners and complainers. And I mean in the sense that they are not positive contributors. They're oftentimes very critical of our closest allies. And they're creating all sorts of divisiveness, and there's a lot they aren't doing that they could be doing. So I'm really hesitant when I look at people say, well, what blogger should I read? Well, I don't recommend very many. I recommend two. I think J.T. Eberhardt's blog's good, and J.T.'s done a good job, and he's a courageous guy, and I think Hemet does an excellent job. For some reason, Hemet's really good at staying out of the shit that everybody else seems to get into. So the bloggers are not the people out there forming groups, supporting people, raising funds. You know, most of them are not doing that. Now, some of them do help raise funds, I'm not saying that, but they just aren't, they're not contributing in the way I think they should and could. Next, number three is treat your allies as valuable partners. Don't treat your friends and enemies like they're enemies. I see too many people saying, well, we don't agree, so I have to hate you. Or I have to write nasty stuff on Facebook about you. Or I have to write a blog. Or I have to write a comment on a blog. So that's just divisive. And generally speaking, you agree with this person 80 or 90%. Why are you pissing them off? Why are you getting mad at them? Why are you saying all these nasty things when you're basically allies? How many of you have seen that happening in our community? Yeah, look, half the hands just went up. So if you can articulate your respective goals and find that you've got 50 to 60% at least of goals in common, then you're allies. Don't treat your allies like enemies. You have real enemies out there. Keep your focus on who the real people are, or the real issues are. So, lesson number four, activism won't make you happy. Happiness is simply a byproduct of activism. And sometimes you may never be happy about some stuff. I'm certainly not happy about some recent stuff that just happened. Won't say anything else. But I think you get a sense of accomplishment from activism, a sense of camaraderie and a sense of purpose. You get a sense of fulfillment from seeing other people prosper and benefit from what you've been active in. I mean, the Micah Ministries people, Denise back there is the guilty party involved. Micah, you were doing some great work and helping some real people. Number five, and this is a really important one. Fear is a poor motivator towards progress. Yes, fear is a part of being an activist. I'm not saying it's not. But fear will eat you up and spit you out. Activism must be driven by a positive vision. Even if that vision's really small. And if your big dreams get crushed, then refocus on something smaller and get started again. That's really important, because you're just not going to get what you want in this life every time. And you're going to get knocked down pretty hard sometimes. But getting back up and moving forward is what it's all about. Number six, ideologies do not reflect reality. Think about that. An ideology is not a model for reality. And almost all ideologies go off the rails sooner or later. So recognize that an ideology, that you probably buy into some kind of ideology. All of us probably do. I'm not saying ideology is by itself bad. I am saying that it will go off the rails sooner or later. It always does. So be prepared to expand and change. Be prepared to not let the ideology control what you think, evaluate, and believe. And that ties into number seven, the illusion of independence. We all have this illusion that we are independent and capable of our own thinking. We underestimate how much our institutions impact us, how much our culture impacts us, how much our religious training impacted us. Your culture influences you as much your ideology as anything else around you. And it's just good to get out of what I call the United States bubble. I just got back from Africa. They think we're fucking idiots in Africa for electing Donald Trump. I'm just saying it. Now, that's getting out of the U.S. bubble. You know, somebody in Namibia said, what are you guys thinking about? What were you thinking? Or we hadn't elected him yet, but they were still thinking that. So get out of the bubble, read something else. I like to go to BBC News, or I like to chime into some outside news source and see what they're thinking, Al Jazeera or something like that. So try to stay as close to humanity as you can and don't succumb to dogma. Dogma is generally always bad, but humanity is what we're focused on. Number 8, be strategic. Focus your time and money and energy on a limited number of goals, and don't get distracted by the latest crisis and fad. I see so many people just willy-nilly going one place to the next. They never stay focused. Well, you lose 90% of what you're trying to accomplish by changing directions. Every time you change directions, you lose all the investment you just put into that direction. So find out what your focus is, what your activism, and do it. Read Rules for Radicals. I think the guy has got, he's dead now, but Saul Alinsky did a brilliant job putting things together. Now, here's a really offensive thing. Facebook activism is not activism. You ain't doing nothing but pissing other people off and making yourself feel good on Facebook. It does not get you out of your chair. It does not get you out of your comfort zone. It doesn't make you connect with another human being. You may not even know that other human being. Now, I'm sure every one of you can say, well, I helped change somebody's mind years ago. And no, I don't give a shit. Facebook is not activism. Get out and do something. So if it gives you the illusion you've done something, you're just intellectually masturbating. Use the 80-20 rule. I've been told I'm over time, but I'm going to finish up real quick here. Focus 80% of your energy on what your core mission is. Focus 20% on supporting your allies. And don't let your allies shame you into doing more for them. And don't expect them to do more for you. Give your 20%. That's fine. Here's where my activism is. 80% building and supporting a community in the secular world. I'm very interested in how do you build community, just like what we're doing here. I help run Recovery from Religion. I support Oasis. And I'm into educating seculars about sexuality. The other 20% I have is being pissed off about Donald Trump and separation of church and state. So here's the deal. Follow your money. If you're putting your money into something, you're probably committed to it. If you will not or don't put your money into something, you probably aren't committed to it. I think money tells you where your values are. And if you ain't giving no money to nobody, then your values are questionable. You're not expressing your values, at least not positive values. So if you got $500 for charity this year, 400 of it should go to the core missions. So my core missions are things like Recovery from Religion and Oasis. So my money's going into those organizations. Number 9, and this is the last one, so Josh won't get too upset with me. When people listen to the behavior. Think about it. Listen to the behavior. What people do is the best guide to their values. What people say is often a response to social pressure, perceived desirability, and fear of disapproval. I do not listen to what people say. I listen to what they do. And because somebody's secular does not mean they're ethical. Just because someone identifies themselves that way. Some of the seculars, I have known a few seculars, they have the ethics of a snake. I say be careful of those folks. They can be very damaging, very dangerous. If you've watched what I've gone through the last year, you probably know what I'm talking about a little bit. Models for activism, I see some great models here. We have KCAC. Who's KCAC members in here? Look at that. Cool. Love it. Kansas Atheist Coalition is doing a great job. They are very good at sticking to their mission and purpose. I think the Satanic Temple on a national level is doing a really good job. And I won't go into detail. I wish I had time, but I'd love to describe why I think they're so good. And I think Freedom from Religion Foundation is very strategic in the way they interact. So, why be an atheist? Because you want to make a difference in someone else's life or in the community. You want to be part of a solution. You don't want to be part of a problem. You want a place to put your ideals into action. Put your ideals into action, and you want to learn how to impact organizations, institutions, and society. So, are you an activist? Let me show you some activists. Here's an activist. Here's another activist. And there's the most notorious of all. He told me himself he was an asshole, so I'm going to just take his word for it. And another activist. All right. And there's a whole bunch more activists. All these people are activists. And boy, we really miss Billy. Sure love the guy. So here's the way I'm going to close it. I'm no longer accepting the things I cannot change. I'm changing the things I cannot accept. So today, I've got my books in the back there. Every dime of every book sale goes to Oasis. So if you want a book, or if you want to give your best friend a book, or give it a late Christmas present, go buy the book. And all the money today goes to Oasis. So thank you. Appreciate the time to talk to you.
We have time for like one or two questions if you want them.
Okay.
I saw a hand pop up.
Question, yeah.
Here, wait for the mic. Wait for the mic. The way the podcast can hear what you're saying.
I recently read an article, I think it was by Lindy West, and she made an interesting point, which I thought was really good. And I just sort of had a question for you. The point she made is there's a lot of great activists around issues that you or I may personally care about, so we don't need to reinvent the wheel, but we can seek out some of the leaders in those different organizations. Is there a good resource, the internet, Ron and I were talking earlier, has become a power for good, but also a power for lies.
Yeah, right.
A place for misinformation. And so I was just kind of curious how you work with other leaders and connect with other leaders of the different issues you support.
Well, I could spend days talking about that. I don't have a quick and easy answer for you. I do think the most important thing isn't that part of the question. The most important thing is, what is your mission? What do you want to achieve on this planet in this lifetime? And then how are you going to focus that? I think once you really define that and refine it, and I don't mean it's for a lifetime. I find things that I want to stay involved with for 10 years, and I move on and find something else. That's okay. But refine what you want to be and what you want to do with that extra time that you're going to give. You're working 8 hours a day. You've got 2 hours a day or 10 hours a week or whatever you got to give somewhere else. Once you refine that, I think you will then go out and find the people you want to connect with. It's less important who's out there now. It's more important who you are. And I have found that I automatically, if people come to me, or I just seem to find them once I've refined my vision. But if I don't know what the fuck I'm doing or want to do, then how am I going to find the person that's going to help me? Nobody's going to tell me how to be an activist. I got to do it myself. Okay, thanks. Good question. Was there one? Yeah. Larry?
Yeah, just a comment. I grew up in Wichita. We've talked about
this. Yeah, I know, yeah.
And I grew up not far from the West Side Christian Church.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, close to on 434 North Gordon.
Uh-huh.
And we went to church, did like you, 3 or 4 times a week.
What church was that?
The Church of God in Market and Maine.
Oh,
Market
okay.
And Market and Lincoln. Yeah, okay.
Right, I know where it is.
And we used to sing that song in Sunday school, Jesus Loves the Little Children, you know, all the little children of the world. And there were never in our church any people other than white people.
Yeah, that's true.
And even up through high school, there were never anybody but white people there.
Right.
And I've often wished somehow human beings were born with something in them at an early age that asked a question, why do I sing this song about Jesus loving all these people, but
none of them seem to be
we
here.
We don't. They're not here, you know. And yeah. They lived, you know, like you know, in Wichita, they lived sort of on the north side of town. And
one of the most segregated cities in the United States. And was then and still is. Yeah.
They seem to move. They just kind of follow the path of the white people moving out of the areas and leaving them sort of impoverished.
Well, there was a lot of redlining going on in Wichita at that time.
Yeah,
for sure.
So
when we were growing up,
so I've often wished that I'd been more aware as a kid and asked my parents questions.
Well, and I want to respond briefly to that. That's what I mean by watch what people do, not what they say. If what they do, what they say is, oh yeah, I'm all into being inclusive and I've got all these friends that are in different ethnic groups or whatever, and I go to their house and there's never anybody there of any other color, and then that tells you something. Or if you see them interacting with people, watch what they do, not what they say. That's the most important thing. All right, Josh, are we finished?
Oh, yeah, we're done, Darrel.
All right.
Great job.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.